Today, we're working with our friends at Mankato Motorsports in Mankato, Minnesota.
Hi folks, I'm Nate with Two Guys in a Ride, and today we're here at Mankato Motorsports in Mankato, Minnesota with Aaron, and we're here to talk about the new 2021 Arctic Cat RIOT X.
Yeah.
Which is a new design for this year.
Yeah, brand new for 21 here.
Okay, so I know, Aaron, can you just, sort of in a nutshell, tell us some of the basic things that would change this year, and then we can go over them in detail.
Yeah, so the RIOT here for Arctic Cat came out a couple years ago, which is their 146-inch track suspension, which is considered a crossover. New for 21 this year in the X series would be the monorail that they put in the back, which is similar to the Mountain to their Alpha. They call it the Alpha 1 rail, which is a single beam suspension over the traditional two rail suspension.
Okay, and then as far as the A-arms on this particular one, you know, we were talking a little bit earlier about the different setups for mountain riding versus trail riding. This is sort of considered a crossover, correct?
This is considered a crossover where you have a typical mountain A-arm or width of the skis would be a 36-inch stance. This one is adjustable from 38 to 36.
Okay.
With the moving of a few pieces here and down in the ski.
And then, you know, it's interesting to note that even just the placement of the actual front skis.
Yes.
So tell us about the placement here and how it can change and what it means.
So inside of these skis here, if I move over here, there's a couple of different spacers in here. Typically when you're trail riding, you want to have a little more stable stance for the faster riding. And so you'd move them to the outer position, which would be taking this bolt off and moving the spacers to the other side to kick this ski out another couple inches here.
Okay, and you know, it's what's interesting to me is how that isn't that much space.
It doesn't seem like
but it will be when you're
correct.
At speed and driving.
Correct.
It's amazing. I mean, it's just like dynamics on a car. One little slight change can really alter the driving thing. Now, you also have some adjustable shocks.
Yeah, this one has the FOX adjustable shocks all the way around. So you'll have three different settings in both the front and the rear skid to be able to do a softer or more firm setup depending on your terrain or snow conditions typically.
All right, and then in the back you also have this adjustable shocks.
Yep, they have FOX shocks all the way through. So there's another one, I think it's probably
the adjusters on your side there.
So you can set up the rear of the suspension as well.
And actually, I can see two of them right here.
Yep.
So this is something I think that people have been watching what's coming out are probably most curious about is this back.
That back new skid.
So walk us through this, because typically you're going to see gaps in the track.
Correct.
Which is where it gets gripped in the front, and then that's what helps to power it. Now you got a single opening down the middle. So
correct.
Being that
this one is just a single beam rather than a traditional, it's going to be easier in deeper snow to tip the machine on the side and still be able to leave part of the track on the ground to gain your traction, right? So you'll see the windows. There's no real windows cut out on the side of the track because they have to run a little bit of a different driver system in the front in order to move the track over a single beam versus a traditional suspension, as well as like their ice scratcher setup, which is these hooks up in the front here that you see. So ice scratchers typically, when people are used to seeing those, are mounted on the suspension. Being that this single beam is sitting in the middle of the track, they mounted these to the top tunnel. And what the ice scratcher does is if you have a very packed, heavy snow that you're not kicking enough snow up, which in the cooler to cool the suspension, you'll put the scratchers down to actually dig up more snow and keep your machine cool so it doesn't overheat basically on the trail.
So you mentioned a little bit earlier about, you know, the track being set up so you can tip the snowmobile easier.
Correct.
So for those of you who are familiar with riding in deep snow, you'll know exactly what Aaron's talking about. For the rest of you that are going, huh? Now, why am I tipping my snowmobile over? I thought the whole point was to was to ride upright. Tell us why you would be tipping it over.
So typically, when you go out, like say you go out and ride Wyoming, Colorado in a lot heavier powder snow, if anybody that's rode out there knows, you can't really do too much with just turning the skis, because if you turn out there and expect the machine to go there, you're just going to keep piling straight ahead into more snow as you go straight. So what they call kind of a powder turn is getting off to the side of the machine, that you want to turn, you'll actually tip the sled down and counter steer. So if I wanted to turn this machine off to the left, I would tip the machine down to the left and I'd turn right, which is going to plant my outer ski into the snow and guide me around. And you're actually turning with the track and not the skis or the handlebars.
Interesting. All right, that would take a little practice. Huh?
Yeah, that's a little bit different than the flat land riding that we're used to in Minnesota.
Try to practice that without any trees around.
Yeah, probably okay. Good advice.
All right, so anything else under that? I mean, that is a really unique.
Yeah, it's kind of a unique track system. Same with a new 121 on this specific Riot X model is a little bit shorter tunnel. You'll notice that this tunnel ends a little bit shorter than a typical tunnel that would come out past the track.
Yep.
So for deeper mountain riding, a lot of guys will actually remove the snow flap so that you can kind of get through more snow or get more snow to evacuate through the back of this, and having the shorter tunnel will actually get you through more snow. The more you can get out, the further
right,
you can go.
Right.
Yep.
So sitting here, Aaron, one of the things that just pops right in front of you is the handlebars.
Yeah.
So they're extremely upright.
Right.
So are you typically standing when you drive this, or does it depend if you're trail?
It's kind of dependent on trail or off-trail riding. Most of your off-trail riding will be standing. You can see, too, on this Riot X, it's a little different than even, say, the standard Riot for 21. The steering stem is more of it comes straight up out of the steering stem here, versus you can actually see where the standard Riots come angled a little bit more towards you, geared for maybe more sitting, where when you're standing, just your center of mass is going to be right all around where the steering stem comes out. It gives you a lot more control over the machine while you're standing up and riding it.
Okay, so the X kind of puts the off-road.
Yeah, the X kind of gears more towards the off-trail than on, but okay. Still very capable on and off-trail.
Right, correct. Now, what is this built in here for?
So, that's a kind of a grab bar, and that's going to be, again, probably a little bit more useful off-trail or mountain riding. So typically, when we talked about that turn, you have to kind of get on one side of a snowmobile and get your weight over there. This bar is actually going to help you in some certain instances grab it here and get the machine over on edge.
Okay.
Not sure if you've ever mountain rode. Some of the hills are pretty steep, and if you need to do a turn or a turnaround, you're going to have to stand on one side of the machine and grab all your weight to keep it over on edge.
And no, my snowmobile riding has been trail riding, so
yep.
not deep snow. So this is really interesting to find out. Okay, and while we're back here, let's talk about some of the instrumentation, the controls that you've got up here. Maybe we'll start over here on the left side.
Sure, kind of a newer control setup here that Arctic Cat implemented is you got this little speedo deal here is going to basically adjust the display for you. It's going to do all the same things that you can do with the push buttons on the display, but you can do it from the handlebars and just kind of cycle through what you want to see on the display. You do have handlebar warmers, low and high. This will adjust your temperature on the bars, and this will adjust your temperature on the heated throttle.
Okay.
Yep. You got forward and reverse here, which is also the start button. So your electric start would be one press to start this. To put the machine in reverse, you'd hit the button again. The engine will shut itself off, spin in reverse, and then you can move in reverse.
Okay.
You hit it again, and it'll shut itself down again and spin forward, taking you back to forward.
And we have some interesting covers. What are you calling these?
Yeah, frog skin's kind of standard in the indie industry here, too. It's just basically going to get some of that air movement, but keeping a lot of the snow dust out of your machine. So, it's kind of a standard now on everything you'll see. You'll see a lot of frog skin material that's very breathable, but still keeping a lot of the stuff you don't want through your motor and your air intake through there.
Okay, and you do have a pull start right here in case you're
battery dies. Yep, there is a pull start in case you need it. You got a little device here, a little red tether.
It's like on boats.
Yep, just like on a boat. It's something you want to clip onto you. If you do end up falling off the machine, this will kill all the power to it so the machine comes to a stop and doesn't
And either
take off.
Sinks in the deep snow.
Yep, yeah, that too.
Or waits for you.
Yep, exactly.
let's talk about obviously someone's got to power this.
Yeah.
So what do we have under the hood, so to speak?
Under the hood is the C-Tech 28000, which is an 800 series engine. It does have the boosted injectors that is kind of standard now for all the higher horsepower engines. It does put out 165 horsepower, which is in line with the 850 series engines from everybody else that has them out there. So same 165 horsepower in this engine. All fuel injected nowadays too. There's not really any more carburetors or chokes anymore. So it's all easy to start, easy to maintain.
So Aaron, tell us a little bit. We've got the covers off the engine here. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about this, what's over here we see, and then we'll go to the other side.
So what you got over here is the exhaust side or the chain case side. So you got a fill here for oil injection, and then the chain case is directly behind here. That's actually going down to your drivers. That's moving the track. Fuel tank, obviously, here, some fuses, but mostly an exhaust side over here.
Okay, so the fuses are up here, you said?
Yeah, this is just a bank of fuses in here, 303 electrical.
That makes it nice and easy to handle. Okay, and then if we step over to the other side.
Tell us what we're looking at.
Yeah, over here we're looking at the PTO side or the clutch side here. You got a primary and a secondary clutch. With obviously the belt moving in between there. So how the snowmobile clutches work is when this starts, that primary is gonna spin up, and at a certain RPM or throttle response, that sheave is gonna close. It's gonna pull down and it's gonna start moving your secondary, which basically is connected to that chain case we looked at on the other side, which will actually start moving your track and your drivers.
What's this?
That would be your coolant. There are liquid cooled engines over fans, so there would be like a 50-50 mixture of coolant in there to keep the sled cool.
And this,
down.
Of course, is your gas.
Gas fills right up there, yep.
So, I mean, everything, some of the basic things like checking your coolant, this kind of stuff, you know, would be easily accessible.
Everything's pretty easily accessible. It's pretty easy, and like you said too. Now everything's fuel injected, and they've made it a lot easier now to just kind of throw your fluids in, start them, and go. You know,
talk to us a little bit about what's up in the driver's information display. You got two screens.
Yeah, Arctic Cat does a dual screen on theirs here too. So. Without the machine running, I'll just kind of explain it, but you can kind of select what you want to see on there. A lot of your typical stuff like a trip one, trip two, total odometer for miles, your engine hours. Yep. Another thing that you'll see on most sleds that I guess a lot of guys will use out in the mountains would be your elevation, and your RPM is kind of more what you look at out west than a speed by any means. You kind of the higher you go in elevation, the more your RPMs are affected. Right. So there's always kind of, most guys out west will leave that on how high they are in the elevation and what RPMs they're hitting to get the peak performance out of their engine.
All right. What kind of a storage, you know, do you have if you're going to be off trail riding? Is there any sort of built-in storage?
Yeah, so Arctic Cat offers here their rear tunnel bag, which you can unzip here.
Okay, so I mean, you got a little bit of room back there.
Yeah, you got a little bit of room back there for maybe an extra hat, face mask, gloves, stuff like that. They also give you a goggle bag up front here. I know a lot of guys like to bring an extra pair of goggles with them, or if things get foggy or on a deep day or deep snow day, it's nice to kind of switch them out. You put them up here, the heat of the engine will de-thaw your goggles while you got the backup pair on. Yeah,
and there's no extra storage underneath the seat.
Not under the seat. That's actually where the battery is now. Okay. So traditionally, batteries on electric starts, sleds were up front in the engine bay. A lot of these manufacturers have moved them out back now with the whole new design and the bigger engines and kind of filling that area with more engine.
What you can obviously buy some accessories, some bags that you can fit on the tunnel.
Yeah, they sell all kinds of accessories. If you do need more storage, you can do extra tunnel bags on the back. They do sell like handlebar bags for more storage here. You know, again,
probably 1,000 ways to customize.
Yeah, the sky's the limit when it comes to that, and you know.
And you sell those here?
Absolutely. Yeah, we have a whole range of Arctic Cat and every other brand. If you're looking at Arctic Cats or aftermarket. We have them all here.
Now, the headlight and taillight, those are LED?
Correct. Yeah, well, your rear taillight is a halogen. The front on the new Riot X is an LED headlight assembly now.
Okay, and you got a high and low beam.
Correct, yep.
Okay.
And they're always on a snowmobile.
And they're always on.
Always on, at least low, yep.
Just like your typical snowmobile you think of. The number 146, for those who haven't, you know, ridden snowmobiles much, refers to the track length.
Track length, yep. So that's a common question that we go over with customers a lot, of all the different lengths of the tracks, and it's a little deceiving to think of 146 inches because a lot of people just think that that's how much should be. 146 is actually the entire length of the track, so it's a little deceiving because a lot of it you can't see. That comes up in here and around the drivers, so you maybe expect it to be a little more, or in some people's cases, less. When you put them all next to each other, they're a lot closer than people think from one size to another.
In looking at the lugs on the track, I just, you know, I noticed how different they are. I mean, you've got some that are, you know, 7-8 inches long and some that are just a couple inches long.
Yeah, and everybody kind of does a different design on their their tracks. Your Arctic Cat, this is a 2.6 inch paddle on it, basically. So it's a little bit deeper lug. Again, going to shine a little bit more off trail. Going to be able to get you through a lot more of that heavy, wet snow or the big snow days. This should move a lot more snow and help you get places a lot further than the smaller trail tracks will get you.
Right. Okay. Talking about, you know, on the side here where your feet would go, you've got a lot of openings.
Yep. That's another big standard here. That's kind of moving into almost all the trail sleds too. But on the running boards, there's a lot more cutouts now to shed snow through them. If you've rode some of what the older sleds used to be that never had those after in a day of riding, you'd be kicking the running boards to chop all the ice up and kick it all out of your running boards. And a lot of the manufacturers now are just cutting through a lot of that in order to shed more snow so ice doesn't build up and your feet don't slip off.
Then you notice right on the edge of those, there's just the whole edge is serrated.
Yeah, it's
so what's that for?
Again, this is going to be a lot more grip on this sled because, like you'd mentioned before, too, with the whole design of the handlebars and the crossover, there's going to be a lot more standing on this sled than sitting. And so, you want to make sure that you have a good grip with your boots. When you are doing mountain riding or off trail riding, you're doing a lot of standing up. You got to make sure that your boots aren't going to slip off the running board in the middle of a hill climb or something.
That would not be good.
No, it's not fun.
Now, on the front, do you call these ski loops?
Yeah, the ski loops, yep.
Okay, but they're essentially designed to pull the snowmobile out of a drift.
But they're also designed, you know, the skis are all made out of this plastic. So essentially, this is kind of keeping your loop up. It's actually pulling the front of your ski up, and you're pulling the front of this up and attaching it down here, which is, you know, if you see a ski, some of the other brands or aftermarkets, they actually almost look flat until you pick out what loops you want and you bend the front of them up.
Oh.
That way it's not cutting straight into snow or catching things. Right. This loop is also helping hold up the front of the ski.
So are they designed, so I get that they're holding that up. Is it actually strong enough that you can, like, let's say you get stuck, you could tie a rope to one of these or bolt and pull?
Yeah, typically that, or you find a buddy that owes you a favor, and then he gets to grab it while you work the throttle, and he'll pull you out.
I like that one. Aaron, anything else you want to mention about this? You know, it's brand new for 2021.
Brand new for 2021. It's a really cool sled. We've had a couple of them through here already, too. We've got a few left. The sleds are moving pretty fast right now with the time of year it is, so. So there's a couple more here left to come down and check out.
Speaking of which, you can always find them at www.mankatomotorsports.com. Okay, and you can check them out. Aaron's right here. And on behalf of two guys in a ride, thanks for taking your time out, Aaron, today to help us review this beautiful Arctic Cat RIOT X.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Thank you.